This is Ham Radio Now, episode 241, one of the fastest turnaround Ham Radio Nows that I've ever accomplished, and it's going to be quick. This is called Parity in Missouri. Got to be careful of those folks in Missouri. They're from Missouri. We got to show them. Well, they're going to show us in just a minute. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and over my shoulder, Arvin, hamradionow.tv. Stop there if you enjoy the programs. So I think you're going to like this one, and you can help us pay the bills, stuff like that. I got a Facebook message from one of the folks that watches the program, and I've got this. Oh, that's the fella. That's not what I wanted to show. Just hang on there for a second, Larry. That's what I wanted to show. I got a Facebook page. Get rid of some of the junk here for the show. Ham Radio Now. It's a public group on Facebook. A lot of you guys are on there. I think there's about 600 people, a little more than 600 that are on there. So if you haven't joined that and you're on Facebook, it's one of the early places to get notification of programs. And so there is that. And then there is this guy who contacted me on Facebook. That's not a great place to contact me. I don't always see those messages really, really quickly, but I happen to see yours, Larry. You are Larry Scantlin, KE0KZ. Got that right?
That's me. That is correct.
And you contacted me with a fairly interesting story, and then I called you on the phone a few minutes ago and got more and more interested, and I thought, well, okay, let's not do this twice. Let's just do it once, or at least half of it is going to be new to me. But we'll start with the stuff that we've already talked about. Okay. You have introduced a companion or a parallel bill to the federal Parity Act that is in Congress, it's in the House of Representatives, and it's in the Senate as a Missouri bill. And you got this done by yourself.
Well, I started it by myself. It's not getting done by myself, of course. But it was kind of a brainstorm idea I had, but it grew out of necessity.
The first thing that I worry about something like this is, do we want lots of individual states coming up with their own act? And there's going to be some answers to that. But you did contact the league. You talked to Dan Henderson and Chris Imlay, and they all said, yeah. So not a problem, right? Yeah. All right. So let's take a look at the act itself. Looking at the Missouri House of Representatives website, and currently that's where it is. This is the bill. It's a Missouri bill, HB 1951. Introduced by the sponsor, Brian Spencer. And when did you actually introduce that? When did it get started?
Well, it got started before the holiday season when I met with Brian Spencer over these issues that related to my city, the city of Wentzville, Missouri, that had an ordinance that prohibited licensed amateur radio operators from being able to have equipment, ham gear, even handy talkies in their private residences without paying a conditional use permit and a fee of $150. And so in that process of getting the city to come around to the ruling of PRB 1 and getting their city ordinances in line with that ruling and providing reasonable accommodation and limited restriction, Mr. Spencer and I spoke about HOA issues and things of that nature in conjunction with getting the city to change. And he actually spoke in behalf of my effort with the city. And so that's what kind of propagated this whole conversation about moving forward with a companion bill or a mirror bill to the federal legislation before the Congress today.
Okay, so we are getting ahead of ourselves, and which is something that, you know, it's a danger here on television programs because we try to get everything through all at once. We're still in that territory that we've already talked about on the phone. So I'm going to dial back just a little bit. So this started toward the end of last year.
Correct.
And I'm going to go back to the bill. Let's look at the text of the bill. Well, this is the introduction, prohibits the use of deeds, restrictive covenants, contractual obligations, the usual language. This is the actual text of the bill, and it is pretty much exactly the same as the federal Parity Act. So that's what you had a representative introduce into the legislature for you. But before that, and as you were just referring to, you had something that was outside of the domain of homeowners associations and purely in the territory of PRB1 when you were living in a suburb of St. Louis. And I think you told me that you got a letter or something that suddenly you're not in compliance.
Correct. My wife and I had come back from a vacation out of Branson, Missouri, and in our mail was a letter from the city officials stating that I was in violation of a city code with respect to outside antennas. In particular, I had placed a vertical antenna, MFJ2990 vertical all band antenna. In my backyard, attaching it, mounting it to a post of my deck. You couldn't even see it from the front yard, but nevertheless, someone in the neighborhood alerted the city as a result of that, and I received this letter in the mail saying I was in violation of city ordinances with respect to antennas, which then grew into conversation about the whole issue of being a licensed ham radio operator and having equipment in my home. And as I read through that city ordinance, I, of course, immediately began to do my research to try to determine, well, what was this city code and why was I in violation of something such as this? I discovered that the city itself had passed an ordinance so back in 2011 or so requiring anyone who was going to have amateur radio equipment in their home, in their private residence, must submit a conditional use permit and pay a fee of $150. and so I thought, seriously? How would they have passed such a thing in such recent years, especially since PRP1 has been around since 1985?
Yeah, and we'll get to that. We'll get to that in a second. But first things first, who did you see in Branson?
Oh, hey, we saw Billy Dean. great show. And we saw the Hey Goods and Pierce Arrow. So, you know, we had a great time. So, I wasn't going to let that dampen my recent experiences in Branson.
Yeah, not the question you were expecting me to ask, though, was it?
Keeping it light.
Okay, so you got back from the vacation and you had this letter. And as you dug into things, you found that your town, what town was that again? It's a suburb of St. Louis, but what's the town?
Wentzville, Missouri. It's about 40 miles from downtown St. Louis. It's in St. Charles County, right next to O'Fallon, Missouri, St. Peter's, Lake St. Louis, places like that, right on Interstate 70 and US 61 that goes up to Hannibal.
Beautiful place to live, right?
It's a great place to live.
Right. So you got back and you found this letter, and as you dug into it, they weren't going to prohibit amateur radio. They were just going to charge you $150 and you had to file for it. The option to say no as well?
Of course. I mean, there was a lot to this. It wasn't just a matter of, asking for permission. Actually, the whole process of conditional use permits had to go through committee. I had to submit surveys and plats and designs and draw engineered drawings of how my antenna was going to be placed and a whole ordeal of paperwork. And this is what the city said was why they charged the $150, is because they had to jump, they had to spend a lot of man hours in looking through all the paperwork and considering all the engineered submitted drawings.
And this wasn't a 75-foot tower. This was a vertical.
Correct. It wouldn't have mattered. I could have had a inverted V wire dipole up, and they still would have required the same conditional use permit filing with all of its accompanying certified documents.
So let's stick with just this, and we won't get into the homeowner stuff yet. What did you do?
Well, I've always believed that, while I may not agree with the system always, I know how to work within the system. And if I can get people who make the decisions about these kinds of things over on my side, I can make change. Now, immediately, I just reacted, of course, in a normal way, is that this can't be happening. You know, they're surely not serious.
And don't so call I started, me Shirley.
Yes, well, I know. Shirley's on another channel. But nevertheless, I decided to make contact with, first of all, the person who sent me the letter to find out what was really going on. And then proceeded to do my research and due diligence to find out what did the city ordinance actually say. And from there, of course, I started having email communications between me and other staff members, resulting in nothing more than, sorry, but that's what you got to do. And so when I realized I was not going to get anywhere with the staff, I decided to work within the political framework of the city, which is a board of aldermen. And I knew personally several of the board members. And so
you're one of those. You must be one of those involved type people.
Well, you know, people always told me, you know, back when I was a little younger and still in the workforce, since you know I retired in 2014, they always said, "Well, I don't know what I would do when I retired. I'd be bored." And I thought to myself, "Those people need to get a life. I've got too many interests and things I enjoy doing, and family around, and things of that nature. There's plenty to keep me busy." And one of those is staying up to speed with what's going on around me.
All right.
And who's where and doing what?
So you talked to the alderman, and what kind of reaction did you get?
Well, initially, of course, I spoke to aldermen that I knew would have an open mind and lend an ear, and they were saying, well, that sounds reasonable, and it seems like we should be able to do something. So I had like two of the aldermen immediately. We're ready to work with me and move forward with this. And so then I continued to call the other aldermen and had one-on-one conversations in person and on the phone with each one of them, explaining to them the folly, if you will, of this ordinance.
So you showed them PRB1.
I did.
And something that they were completely unfamiliar with. They crafted their regulations in ignorance of PRB1, which I think we can understand because that doesn't come on the front page of the local newspaper. And how are they going to know that that even exists until a local ham shows them? So you did that. And then what happened?
Well, again, the aldermen, for the most part, the majority, there's six board of aldermen in the city. And I knew I had a majority in favor of change. However, of course, they all have other interests and other fish that they're trying to fry. So they weren't going to barrel in and just knock down the walls. They were going to work within the framework of their system. And so they contacted the city attorney. Who basically his response was more of a protective nature of the current ordinance and basically was stating that this PRB1 really was not speaking of them, that they didn't have to abide by those rules.
Now, PRB1 is pretty clear. It's, you know, it at least to us, it addresses who it addresses. It's municipal, it's, you know, state, local governments. And it tells them what they have to do. He was just kind of putting blinders on, it sounds like, and saying, well, no, that's not us. That can't be us.
Well, I think the real issue comes down to what the word is, you know, what the word is means, you know, because the reality was they felt like they were being reasonable. They thought, well, you know, conditional use permit and paying a fee is what we require. And that it's not like we're saying, no, you do all the, what we tell you that you have to do, and then we'll probably approve it. You go through all of the mechanisms and we'll be just fine.
Okay. Well, then you were able to layer something else on because of what the hams in Missouri had done, in the past.
Well, correct. It turned out that, PRB1, had there was a legislation in the state of Missouri passed back in the early 90s that basically mirrored the PRB1 ruling, giving the state of Missouri the same statutes that PRB1 stated, which was reasonable accommodation, and that the state and local governments cannot preempt or preclude amateur radio operators from being able to place antennas outside and have equipment in their possession in their private residence.
So you were able to add that, and that's something that I've always wondered. Is there value in a state duplicating the federal PRB1? And in because of the way humans operate in legislatures and in assemblies and councils, yes, there's value in that because it's...
Well, exactly.
Oh, okay. I see my state's name on it, not just the great big federal government. But they were still arguing that they thought that they were being reasonable. So how did you get around that?
Well, I basically got around that by continuing to stay in contact and communication with the alderman, because basically the attorney, city attorney, was going to do whatever the alderman said to do. And if I could convince a majority of the board of aldermen that to reconsider and to consider my petition, then it wouldn't matter what the city attorney said. And so basically what I got them to do, because I started calling some of the other cities in the area, cities that had previously dealt with this issue and had actually upgraded, if you will, their ordinances to match the PRB1 ruling. And one of those towns was O'Fallon, Missouri, which is just east of us, about 10 miles. And I contacted their staff and found out that they, in fact, had changed their ordinances, and they were much more accommodating and did not require any kind of submission of conditional use permits for the possession of amateur radio equipment. And their antenna height restrictions and placement of antennas outside was very accommodating. And so I contacted the aldermen, especially those that were, what you might say, my closest allies to this process, and they called as well. And so when the when this got put on agenda, which is the, was the next process, is to get this whole issue put on a board of aldermen weekly agenda meeting agenda, then that's where it could come up for discussion.
Did you at any point contact anybody at league headquarters to ask for advice or help?
I did. In fact, I talked to Mr. Dave Henderson, N1ND at ARRL initially, even with respect to this issue. And he gave me the name of some attorneys that were part of their advisory council to contact to see if there might be someone here that could at least assist me in this process of getting the city to change the ordinance, which I did. I contacted one gentleman. I don't recall his call and name right now, but he was in Jefferson City, which is, of course, the capital of Missouri. And then I contacted one other, and basically they were saying that they felt like they had a case, but they weren't really, unless I was willing to hire them, they didn't really represent the hams in particular through the ARRL.
Yeah, so things seemed to be going well enough for you as you were working through this that you didn't think you needed to hire an attorney you didn't know at that point.
That's correct. And the other thing was I was able to get on local 2-meter repeaters here and generate some interest in this conversation, and spoke to another amateur who lived in O'Fallon by the name of Jay Underdown, W0PS, and he gave me significant advice, and in fact, he ended up becoming a witness for me at one of the meetings with the board.
I was going to say, getting advice from hams on 2 meters is always a great idea. It's kind of like the internet. But it seemed to work out for you this time. All right. I think that the hang-up, to some extent, that you pointed out, is this concept of what's reasonable. Because that's widely open to interpretation. And so your town thought, yeah, $150 in engineering studies and all that stuff is pretty reasonable. The ARRL should generally be able to provide precedent, case law and other decisions that have been rendered over the years since PRB1 came out back in the mid-80s that show that that sort of thing is not considered reasonable. But you know, it becomes, tell it to the judge, you got to be willing to go to court if you want to go there, and you didn't have to get that far.
That's right, and I'd rather not have to do that. I mean, I was prepared to move that direction if we weren't going to get any resolution of the issue at the city level, at the board meeting level. But I felt pretty comfortable with the fact that I knew these board of aldermen personally, and they knew that I wasn't just a disgruntled old man trying to rock the boat. So, we did end up being able to get this on agenda, and that was paramount to getting things changed.
And you said that you had some of the local hams who were witnesses to talk to your board of aldermen. I think people would be interested in a little bit of a description of how that went, because those are tense. I've been in situations like that, and you think you know what you're going to say, and you think you've got all the right things on your side, and you get up there and they start asking you questions. That's tense. It's nervous.
Well, it was, and fortunately, again, I had good people with good experience and background in relating the real issues, and being able to answer those questions. Jay Underdown was a experienced, certified communications engineer professional in the area, in this region, had done a lot of work for cities with respect to cell towers and other types of towers as it related to city concerns. And yet he'd also had been a licensed ham for 49 years, so he'd had experience on both sides of it. And then I had also a young man, a young ham, 80JA, Jacob Nagel, who lives in the area, who came and spoke on behalf of the young ham perspective, and showed there's value in what we provide to beyond just the obvious.
Wow.
And so I thought that all came across well.
Yeah, you're hitting all the golden points. What kind of questions did the aldermen ask? What did they want to know about? It never seems to be the ones that we'd expect.
Well, first of all, I got to let you know that the one alderman that I knew I was going to have problems with, turns out she's the president of the board of my HOA. Oh yeah, the saga continues.
Yeah,
and she wasn't willing to listen to anything of any reasonable information at all. Her concern and those that raised any concern was over two things, which is the typical response. How do you know that this thing won't fall over on somebody's house or on somebody passing walking by and all that sort of thing? In other words, safety issues.
Mm-hmm.
The other
safety issues or safety theater.
Well, exactly. Yeah, exactly. The other issue, which is the one that always comes up, is aesthetics. It doesn't look pretty. It's going to lower the value of the homes in the neighborhood. And of course, there's no merit to that. There's no proven statistics. There's no studies that's ever been done that's ever proved that has ever happened. As a matter of fact, I held my real estate license at one time and sold homes. And I spoke to them from that perspective. I said, I understand curb appeal. And I said, I encourage any one of the members of the Board of Aldermen to come in front of my home and observe my curb. They won't see my antenna.
Yeah, it's so your antenna was invisible from the curb. Of course, exactly. not all ham antennas would be. The guy with the 70-foot tower, that's going to be up there.
Of course, and one of the things that Jay Underdown brought to their attention is that the real issue here is not the antenna. The real issue is the supporting structures. And that's why we had to make sure that whatever we did craft as far as final ordinance and legislation spoke to that issue, that we're dealing with supporting structures. And that could be a whole lot of different things. But the antenna could be a wire strung from tree to tree, or it could be a beam antenna at the top of a tower. But that is not what you regulate. What you regulate and be concerned with is supporting structures.
So what happened once you were done with all your testimony and the aldermen, I guess they talk among themselves, and what was the ultimate result?
Yeah, well, of course, it's just like any political process. It takes a while. It doesn't happen overnight. There had to be the formation of a study on this to see what was O'Fallon doing, What was the difference on its ordinances? Bring that back in a subsequent meeting, and then have additional conversation there. And then once it was approved to go forward, and the attorney for the city reviewed it, then they had to put it in writing what this change was going to be. They had to then, once that was completed and approved by the board, then they had to put it up for public notice, so that the city at large had opportunity to come and speak to it. So it had to be put, it had to have a first hearing and then a final hearing, which is where the city, the Board of Aldermen would then vote.
Okay.
And
so the public notice, that starts to scare me. Because the public can be pretty darn unpredictable. When that happened, did the public see the notice? Did anybody react?
Well, obviously, I didn't go around knocking on doors in my neighborhood or anywhere else to tell them all to show up once for that hearing. And as a matter of fact, there was no one else came at that original hearing for public notice of that bill, of that ordinance. And so there was no dissenting comments or discussion. It went right through, past the first hearing. And at the final hearing and the vote went right as I had hoped and expected, 5-1 in favor of the change.
And so they had crafted new regulations that actually met the definition or met some closer proximity to reasonable accommodation. And what did they ultimately say you could do?
Well, the bottom line was that they agreed to eliminate the current code requirement of a conditional use permit to be filed for the actual possession of amateur radio equipment within a private residence. That's no longer required. Nor is a conditional use permit required to place an antenna on the outside of the home as long as it fell within a certain height restrictions. And those height restrictions were 15% above the average height of a home within the particular district of that home. Every city has different residential districts. And you have R1, R2, R3, and so forth and so on, based on whether they're single family, multiple family, or whatever they might be, condominiums, townhomes, and such. And so for my residential district, which was an R1, a single-family home, the average height of the top of the roof line of a home was 40 feet. And so we could go up as high as 15% above that, or 46.5 feet with a supporting structure before we would be required to file a conditional use permit requesting an exception to that height limit.
So that doesn't sound real great. And now we're beyond what we talked about on the phone.
Correct.
46 feet. Now that's the supporting structure, and then the antenna can go above that.
Well, the test will be as to how, whenever someone puts up 45 foot of Ron 25G tower against their home, and then puts a mast up of 10 feet above that, and has a beam antenna or anything, slopers or whatever they might have, that the ends up extending them up to around 60 feet. I guess that will be the true test of whether they meant what they said in this ordinance, because it basically states supporting structure.
So when did this occur? When did this ordinance revision happen?
It actually went into effect December 1 of 2015.
So this is new.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. So now you'll see. But your antenna, not a problem, because it didn't exceed the height of your roof, at least not much anyway.
Correct.
And dipoles and things, they'll be fine. So, towers.
That's right. So at least I feel like we got, there's currently 97 licensed amateurs in the city of Wentzville, at least that have a city of Wentzville zip code and address. And, my feeling was, a large portion, and I think this is probably true across the country because it's been my experience after 34 years of being a licensed amateur. A lot of fellas and gals get tired of beating their head against the wall and being told no and being told no, and to the extent that they finally give up on the hobby. they put their equipment in a closet, and because they don't want to hassle with trying to climb up inside of attics and be stealth and all that sort of. Not that there's anything wrong with any of that, but I want to have the option of doing those things, not be told I have to do those things.
Yeah, stealth antennas are interesting and they work, but they don't work as well as antennas that are up in the air. I've done both.
Exactly. And this is what we try to relay to the city. This is not like a TV antenna for reception. And even from a reception standpoint, up on 40 and 80 and 160, you've got to have antennas that are significantly and sufficiently long in order to properly and adequately operate in those bands.
Yeah. Okay, so now you're feeling your oats from... I'll modify the enthusiasm to something of a win, because we don't know exactly what it's all going to work out to be. And you met through this process one of the state legislators and started talking about homeowners associations. And so take the story from there.
Okay. That's correct. And he had actually spearheaded a forum related to a lot of negative comments that he was receiving from his constituents regarding HOAs, homeowners associations. Now, this was due to all sorts of things and problems that were inherent in the homeowner association communities. But I saw that as an opportunity to get his support in doing something for all Missouri hams. Because, again, I believe that a lot of amateurs are just tired of fighting the battle with HOAs. And, we needed that help. And so I sat down with him at some length and discussed the issue of these antennas. Shared with him my experiences in other locations with HOAs, and he basically echoed those kinds of problems everywhere in HOAs in his district. And so he said he would be willing, because I basically said, would you author a bill on our behalf? And how does that look? What does that do? And how do we go through that process? And he said he would be willing to do that. And that was, again, right before... the holidays. And so the Missouri legislation had ended their ended their session for last year and was going into holidays. And so he was going to offer this bill at the new session of 2016.
When you were talking to him initially, did you discuss that there was a federal bill that is working its way through Congress and show that you were basically mirroring that, or did you keep it entirely local?
No, I informed him right up front that there's already legislation that had significant bipartisan support at both the House and the Senate of the U.S. Congress, and that it had been in the works for a while, and it was making its way through committee, and it seemed to be having some pretty good responses for favorability. We don't know, of course, how this will all end up, but I said this is already being done on the federal level, but in as much as the state of Missouri had followed through with a companion bill, if you will, for PRB1, I suggested to him that this made sense for us to do something at the state level, and wouldn't it be nice if Missouri was the first to do such a thing?
Yeah, and as we've noted, it was helpful to have a companion bill for PRB1, and we don't know what the outcome of the Parity Act federally is going to be. It may pass this year, it may not. If you guys get something in Missouri, I'm sorry, I pronounced that wrong, didn't I? It's Missouri.
Thank you. It's M-I-S-S-O-U-R-A.
Missouri. Yeah, I'm from Illinois. I should be able to do that better, but I'm from the way other end of Illinois. If you guys get that in your state and that becomes a model, well, if we never make anything federally, maybe we can sort of cascade this from state to state. So, yeah, we'll see.
Well, it wouldn't be the first time that that's happened throughout the country, where the federal was never able to solidify enough support for something, and then the states went ahead on their own And then there was enough states across the country that proposed and got enacted the same legislation that the federal end happened to, they couldn't help themselves but redo the process of looking at it on a federal level.
Yeah. So there's at least one more step here that we haven't talked about yet, and that is you have had a hearing in your state legislature and some hams attended, some prominent hams attended. So once again, there you are under the bright lights and you're nervous making time. Tell me how that went.
Yeah, and this was my first experience to be involved in a real political process at the state level. And so this bill was put on the docket with this committee. And I have to tell you, our representative was real smart. He knew how to make this work better than it would have maybe ordinarily. He was able to get the chairman of a committee that really had nothing to do with this type of legislation to put this in their docket because he owed him a favor. And he called that favor in. And so this went before the Civil and Criminal Proceedings Committee.
That does seem strange.
You think, what difference does it make? Well, it does make some difference because, you know, these people don't deal with this HOA issue every day, you know. And so people that don't really have a strong background and a strong formed opinions, sometimes they're a little bit more easily swayed, if you will, or at least informed on the positive side of it. So anyway, this was put on their docket and went to before the committee on their hearing of this bill on this past Wednesday, January 27th in Jefferson City.
So this is brand new stuff here.
That's correct. And so we had, like you say, we had some witnesses.
There we go. Civil and criminal proceedings.
It
doesn't sound right, but I'll go with it.
Yeah. It sounds kind of, kind of shady, but hey, such is the life of political process.
Yeah. Okay. So how'd it go? What happened?
Well, you know, I thought it went real well. Now in ahead of all of that, the representative told me that we needed a room full of supporting amateurs there. He also said it was important that we get, people who could speak clearly and coherently and it with
some education. Now, wait a minute. Did he want people who could speak clearly and coherently, or did he want a room full of amateurs? Sorry, you guys. I couldn't avoid that.
Actually, both.
Okay, so who did you get? What was your lineup of witnesses?
Well, of course, I went back to my old friend Jay Underdown, who had been with me from the beginning of the city issues, because he did a good job there, and he spoke from that perspective. Because I wanted to get some people who could speak from various avenues of experience, not just disgruntled HOA people. And so, with his consulting engineering background of communications, I wanted him to speak from that perspective, and he was willing to do so. I also was able to get Ward Silver, N0AX, who's a contributing editor to QST and well-traveled, has done a lot of training seminars and conferences all across the country. And he lives just down the road from me here in St. Peter's.
Yeah, I'll stick a programming note here for Ham Radio Now. Ward did the banquet talk at the Tapper Conference, and I haven't put that online yet, but it's going to be coming up in the next week or two, so you'll see that. He's been on the show before, and being a contributing editor for QST is a small part of his resume. He's
correct.
He's a big deal. So
right.
Okay.
Yeah, so I was real pleased to have him on the team and willing to take time out of his busy schedule to appear at this hearing. And so he spoke. And then I discovered from conversations with Dan Henderson that Missouri had just elected a new section manager, Cecil Higgins. Dale Bagley, who was the previous section manager, had stepped down. And so I contacted Cecil Higgins, AC0HA, and brought him up to speed real quick on what was going on. Of course, he felt like he was kind of getting initiated by fire here in this process.
Welcome to the job.
Exactly. That was it's in and other tasks as assigned on his resume or in his job description. But he wanted to review the bill first. And of course, I think he wanted to contact the ARRL and make sure that they were sanctioning all this. And I might just step back for a moment and let you know that we did run this by Dan Henderson and General Counsel, submitted the copy of this bill as when it was written up, and let them know what we were doing, and got them to contact the representative, Mr. Brian Spencer, and speak with him in person over the phone, of course, and give them, you know, have that communication going on between ARRL and their experiences with the Parity Act currently, so that we would go into the state of Missouri legislature with good formulation of the bill and good ideas as to how we could overcome, you know, objections.
So in the hearing, all these guys came up and testified. And once again, we never hear the details of how that goes. I'd love to see some video of it. I don't know if they recorded it. I've seen the hearing that I've been talking about that occurred a couple weeks ago in one of the House committees, and the hams for the Parity Act and the ham operation of it, the ham aspect of it was a small part. And there were some more serious business dealings that they were talking about, and that got most of the attention. In fact, the ham stuff felt to me a little bit like a pat on the head. It was dealt with very quickly, but and that committee didn't vote on it. I've learned. I got to go back to my I'm just a bill up on Capitol Hill and learn a little bit more about this. This was a hearing in the federal Congress of a subcommittee, and not a markup. And I don't know if they use this language in the state legislature, but the hearing is just people talking about it, and the markup is where they vote on it. And they haven't voted it out of this committee yet. That'll happen later on.
This committee will be voting.
Yeah.
But only for the purpose of moving it forward in the process.
But what I wanted to do was get you to talk a little bit about the actual testimony. What kind of questions and give and take did you see happening? And were you one of the witnesses?
I was okay. The first witness. I let others end it up. In fact, I let Ward Silver end up the testimony time because I felt like that he would do a really good job of putting the final touches on our arguments. But at the end of each testimony, the floor was open to any of the committee members to ask questions. And typically they did. I think after Cecil Higgins, they didn't. After me, they did. After Jay Underdown, they did one question, I think. And after Ward Silver, they asked a couple of questions because I think as they went along, some of these came up with more questions to ask. But basically, I thought the testimony time was good. I thought there was the committee members were attentive to what we were saying. The questions were centered right around the same thing about private land use agreements that everybody knew going in that these agreements existed, these indentures, these covenants, and we agreed to them. So, you know, why should we not be required to abide by them? And why should we go back after the fact and try to change them or, you know, eliminate them? And that was the primary questions and concerns.
And what kind of answers did you guys supply?
Well, the real cause, the real answer to that is that, well, we understood that, but the reality is that since the Clean Water Act of 1967, where the federal government requires all new subdivisions, all new developments to place retention ponds in those developments, that becomes common grounds, which then requires the builder and developer, or it doesn't require him, but he's going to form an HOA to manage those common grounds because that developer is not going to be there after he sells out. And so somebody's got to oversee that. And so then we have the formation of management companies to work with these homeowner associations, and all these fees get established and all that stuff. And it no longer in most metropolitan areas and even some smaller cities will you have the option of deciding to live somewhere else. I mean, there was a day that you said, if you found out that they had these antennas restrictions by because of deed restrictions or covenants, you could say, well, I'll move across the street over here where they don't have them. Well, that doesn't exist anymore. And that hasn't happened for about 20 years now, that you could find a subdivision that doesn't have restrictive covenants as it relates to antennas. And so you no longer have those choices. And so we have to reevaluate and revisit the intent of these restrictions and these covenants. And the reality is most of these covenants are cookie cutter, and they're pulled out of a manual somewhere and put into action because the developer and builder, he doesn't sit down and say, well, I want to restrict this, I want to restrict that, and I'm going to put all these restrictions. He doesn't even look at them. He just knows that this county requires, when he forms a development or buys a plot of land and wants to file a plat for developing a home community, he's got to file with it homeowners covenants. Those have to be filed with it. And so they just pull them out in their carte blanche covenants that all pretty much state the same. And until those that homeowner association is formed and turned over to the homeowners, the builders, developers control that whole process. The homeowners don't even have a voice in it. They don't have a say. And even in many cases, and which is the case in my homeowner association right where I live, it becomes sort of a pseudo-government, where you've got people with a little bit of a power, thing going on. They think they're running their little kingdom, and it doesn't matter whether there's a large group of homeowners that don't want something to happen. They push through and keep doing what they've always done, which they think is in the best interest of all.
Yeah, we've certainly seen that from both sides. Homeowners chafe at the restrictions and then start panicking that their neighbors are going to do something that is going to lower their property values. So,
my response to that is, okay, how well did that work when the housing market collapsed in 2005?
Did
that work well for you?
Yep. Okay. So you've been through that hearing. And now the bill is still in that committee. It hasn't been voted out yet. We're in process.
That's correct. And actually, the next step from the representative, he advised me that what we need to do now is blitz these committee members with phone calls and emails asking for their support and a vote of yes in committee so that we can move this on forward. So I love technology, Gary. I have an app on my iPad that allows me to connect to Echolink. And I got on Echolink with my iPad and connected to all of those repeaters across the state of Missouri and started having conversation on the air with amateurs about this bill and the need for their support. And as a result of that, we got things moving.
Just from talking to people on repeaters. You've done mailing lists and
yeah, that's the start of it. And of course there's a guy over in the Kansas City area that has a blog. He's called Larry's List. He didn't ask me if he could use my name, but nevertheless he did. And he's that ham over there. And he's got a blog that's called Larry's List that I've found out that a large number of amateurs, contribute to and participate in. And so I got a hold of him. And he put this out on his blog and in their newsletter and online. I've got it on my QRZ.com page. There's a reciprocal blog in St. Louis, in the St. Louis and Suburban Repeater Club. And I've got it on there. I went to Winterfest, Hamfest over in Collinsville, Illinois, two Saturdays ago, and made announcements. I took these witness appearance forms with me. We got over 100. And some odd amateurs to complete a witness appearance form, which is sort of like a petition of support, and we delivered those to the committee. And now we're just trying to blow up the committee members' voicemail.
Do you get the sense that you may be diluting the federal effort or supporting it by getting more attention to both?
Well, I think the latter is true. I've spoken to a lot of amateurs both on the air and by phone and email who weren't that much aware of what was going on with H.R. 1301 of Senate 1685, the Amateur Radio Parity Act. And in many cases, they kind of said, well, that won't get anywhere. And I have given them the reason to believe that maybe they're wrong, that we can do things at the grassroots level, here at the local state level, that maybe will enhance what's going on at the federal level. Because the reality is, you know, these state representatives, a lot of them have ambitions to become U.S. representatives and state senators. And, you know, it's all about constituency and it's about support. And, you know, if they do something that those that are going to be voting want done, there's a good chance that that just filters right up line. So I can't help but believe that it's a positive thing all the way around.
All right. My mind is going two directions now, and I want to make sure I get to both of these. First of all, is the Missouri legislature, I'm sorry, Missouri legislature, is it bicameral, two houses, or is it a single house?
No, it's two. There's okay. State senators and there's House representatives.
So you'll need to get a companion bill in the state Senate.
I'm glad you mentioned that, Gary, because guess what? Okay. That's already in the works. I'm already on it. And actually, this is, again, where it helps to have somebody on the inside. And just to kind of keep moving this whole conversation together on how this works, this vote, which could be coming up pretty soon. I got an email this morning from Representative Spencer, who says rumor has it that the committee is maybe close to having a vote, and it looks like it's a favorable one. So that was encouraging. And he says that's very unusual for it to move this quickly. So he says this is good news. And he said now more good news is he's talked to a senator who has a bill that he's authored relative to modifications to the state laws regarding HOAs that Representative Spencer says we could put on as an amendment to his bill. We could add our bill as an amendment to his bill. And he says that it could really work.
Yeah, if his bill is going somewhere, so yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And so we're actually, what we're doing is we're now making contact with this senator to ask for him to consider adding our bill as an amendment to his. And, you know, there's a good chance that this could happen. And, you know, I have a friend from my hometown of Sullivan, Missouri, who is a state senator. And so I'm going to be making contact with him. And several others know senators at the state level. So we're already trying to do that. Now, in lieu of that happening, we're still going to push ahead for getting what's called having a state senator become a mule. They call it a mule, which is somebody who brings this bill into the Senate and has a mirror, if you will, or a companion bill at the Senate level. It's exactly what happened with H.R. 1301. They got someone on the Senate side to become a mule, if you will, bring that in to the Senate side.
Senator Wicker in Missouri, in Mississippi, the other state. The one we keep missing up when we try to two-letter state postal codes.
Yeah, exactly.
M-O-M-I-M-E. So you're clearly a go-getter, and I think you were mentioning that you were getting the word out across the state, so you do need the usual contact your representative and let them know that you want them to support this effort.
Well, and you know, it really comes down to that, because I can assure you and what Representative Spencer tells me, this is all about constituents.
Yeah. And the folks that are watching this around the rest of the U.S. and around the rest of the world, there's not much they can do to help you, except that if you guys are successful, or even if you're not, it may happen where you live. So that's the reason for being interested.
We hope we can model this, you know, that this can be a template to some extent of what can happen. And, you know, it's taken some effort, taken some time, but you know what? I told these guys as I've come back now from the hearing, I went and I've actually called each one of the committee members, except the chairman. Representative Spencer says, leave the chairman of the committee alone for right now. call everyone else. And so I did that. I actually one morning this past week, I got on the phone. I called every one of the committee members, and it took me a grand total of 10 minutes, okay, to make contact with all of them and let them know that I was a licensed ham in the state of Missouri, told them where I was located, and told them that I was asking their support and a vote of yes in committee so we can move this bill forward, that we appreciate their support, and I gave them my phone number in case they wanted to call me back and talk with me about it. Now, I didn't reach any of them. These committee, you know, the committee members are busy. They're gone. They have administrative assistants, everything. But it all went to voicemail, which is fine, because it has the same effect. They look at numbers.
Did you get any response back from any of them from the messages you left?
Not the first time. I called again this morning.
Keep trying.
A week later.
You're not going to give up. I can tell.
I followed up, and I said, they said, yeah, you called last night. I said, yes, I did. But I'm calling again to just reiterate my request for support. But I also want to know, have you been getting response? And I kind of like to have a feeling from the committee member as to what his intentions were. And so in about every case, they said they had received a call or two and a few emails. I'll be honest with you. I got to be, you know, I'm a little disappointed in the overall response from the amateurs in the state. And maybe, you know, everybody's busy and we've got a lot of irons in the fire and so forth. And again, I think there's a lot of negative, feelings about the political process in this country, and it causes people to not follow through when it's really so simple. 10 minutes to 15 minutes. It took me 15 minutes this morning to call every one of them. This time I talked to their assistants.
Yeah. There are hams who don't support the Parity Act. I was talking to, Brendan Price yesterday, I was talking to Brendan about that, who expressed very clear feelings that he thought those people were wrong. But there are hams that don't feel that way. As long as we're talking about that, I get the impression that you are fairly conservative politically.
I am. I'm not afraid to say I've voted Republican all my life. However, I still vote my conscience. And, be that, when I say voted all my life, I voted one time Democrat, and that was for Carter. And I regret that.
You live to regret it.
I regret that.
Yeah.
But, I was born in the days of Eisenhower. And Reagan.
You're a young pup. I was born when Truman was president.
Oh, well, there you go.
A few months.
I was born the year Eisenhower won the election, 1952. So, but I am a conservative, and I believe that our country is founded on conservative principles and ideas, and the Constitution bears that out in all the way through, up and down.
Yeah. And go ahead.
I'm all for the rights of the individual, and I respect the rights of everybody. And I've learned something. Whenever I first got my license in 1982 in Dallas, Texas, I was living in Grand Prairie, which is a suburb of Dallas. And, I was all excited about having got my first license. And when I got upgraded to general, I was able to put up a tower. I was going to put up a tower and a beam antenna, because I knew, I'd learned that, horizontally polarized antennas just are much quieter, and you can rotate that around and directionalize it and get so much more pinpoint communications and so forth. But, I lived in a neighborhood much like where I live today, single family homes in a nice, middle class neighborhood. But you know what I did? I went to my neighbors, one on the right, one on the left, one behind, and I explained to them, I introduced myself, and I explained to them what I was about to do, that I was going to put up 60 foot of tower, and there would be guy wires, and there would be an antenna up on top of that. And I wanted them to know what that was all about, that I was a ham radio operator, and that I was providing a public service. Yes, it was a hobby, but there was a lot of positives to it for everybody. And that if they had any problems with that, or if they later, if there was concerns, if there was RFI issues or whatever there were, my door was open. They could come and speak to me anytime about anything related to that tower, my hobby and the amateur radio service that I provided. And you know what? In the 8 years I lived there in Dallas, I not once had a knock on my door, and I spoke to those people all the time. So I've learned that most people react emotionally out of lack of knowledge. It's called fear. They're afraid of the unknown. And once you educate them, and once you're honest and open, and that you're not confronting them in their face with something that they don't want, I believe that people will be reasonable.
Most of the time.
Some that won't, yeah. But most will.
Yeah, most will. I have a similar story from where I live right now. I've got a dipole that is from a tree in the back of the house, across the top of the house, and then across a little cul-de-sac. And the best tree in the front happened to be on the edge of my neighbor's property across the street. We knew the neighbors pretty well at the time. And they said, fine, and put up the dipole. And they said, when are you going to put up that antenna? And I said, that's it. You know, it's right up there. They sold the house. New neighbors moved in. I waited a couple of days. We got to know the new neighbors a little bit. And I said, oh, by the way, I've got a ham radio antenna strung to this tree that is technically on your property. It's way off to the edge. And they said, we'd never saw it. We never noticed. And well, is it okay to keep it there? Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, no problem at all. It might be different if it was a 70-foot tower in the back of the house. When I moved in, there was no homeowners association. The builder still controlled the deal because it was a brand new neighborhood. And we negotiated with them, which is something you can't do necessarily with the existing homeowners association. And showed them some options. And they said, well, now we're not really excited about a tower. And I can't afford a tower anyway. But dipoles and verticals and stuff, they were all going to be fine. As you've gone through this process, politically and among witnesses and anyone else you've encountered, how much opposition have you run into, and how have you dealt with it?
Well, at the hearing itself, of course, the committee members, the chairman had to open the floor once we were done with our positive supporting testimonies to anyone who wanted to come up and testify in opposition. And as you might expect, the HOA lobby was represented, and there was an attorney there. Okay, and it's interesting, you know, no homeowners were there. There was no HOA board members. Nothing that, but their attorney.
So they didn't rally the troops. They just set the mouthpiece.
That's right. And it was interesting because he came across almost accommodating, which was kind of surprising. Hmm. I mean, he wasn't in favor of this. He felt like that we didn't need to have this legislation at all. It was all a matter of, we just need to sit down and carve out some adaptations to homeowners' covenants and indentures. That it was all a matter of just good communications. And
we
all
can
that
work stuff. It out.
Yeah.
And We don't need this legislation. We can work it out. Just come on over.
Well, right. And of course, my experience with HOAs, mine where I live right now, I actually submitted the proper process of requesting an exception to the HOA restriction of no, capital N-O, boldface, and outside antennas. And I requested an exception to that, told them exactly. And they had seen what I put up because, interestingly enough, they were the ones that blew the whistle on me to the city originally. I found this out later. And so I submitted the request, and I was unequivocally denied. No discussion. No, well, we'll see. Let's talk about it. What do you really have in mind? It was like, nope, the covenant state, none. And so there was no option or no opportunity to have a conversation about it.
So I guess now I'm confused because you were initially in trouble with the city, but it sounds like you're also in violation of your homeowners association agreement.
I am. My antenna is up again. I'm going to make them make me take it down.
Okay.
But
they're not watching this story.
The reality, the interesting thing about all this and the wonderful world of politics, again, it turns out that my board member, who's the president of my HOA board, who is also an alderman in the city, who is the only dissenting vote, she lost in that vote. She's running for re-election. She doesn't want any negative press.
Okay.
So they haven't done anything yet.
They've kept quiet.
I'm guessing that once she gets re-voted in to the alderman position, if she does, I'll probably hear from her.
Yeah. Have you talked to your neighbors much about this in your current location?
Oh, yeah, of course. My surrounding neighbors, my next door, two or three doors down and so forth, they're fine. The gentleman is next to me on the south side of me is a retired fire chief. He knows all about amateur radio. He related all kinds of anecdotal experiences that he had as a city fire chief. And it was all positive. He had no problems with it. The fellow to my west, cause I'm on a corner, is a teacher in the school district, and he's very positive about it. He said his father was a ham radio operator. You know, I've had, you know, pretty much positive responses to people that live in the neighborhood.
All right. So the other thing I was going to mention was I'm glad to give you all the publicity possible here on Ham Radio Now. I think it's going to be very popular. People are going to watch this. To the extent anybody watches this program, you know, we've talked for an hour or so, and people will watch the first 5 minutes of it and then kind of drift away. There's a very famous ham in Missouri that you probably are familiar with who's got his own TV show. I wouldn't recommend that you tell him I sent you, but I'd recommend that you talk to him. You'll get a couple of minutes, and I think he'll be interested in what's going
on. Bob Heil.
Yeah, that's the guy. At least make your pitch to him. And I don't know if you know Christian Kudnick, K0STH. He's there in St. Louis. He does an audio podcast called 100 Watts and a Wire.
And I've seen it come up on some ARRL newsletters.
Yeah. So he's a neighbor of yours, and he might be interested in talking to you too. You never know. And there's a whole bunch of other programs and stuff. So
Very good. You
can get the word out, but you beat on me first, and look, you made it on TV. How about that?
I appreciate your time and your willingness to do this, because I think it is of interest to an awful lot of folks. And we'd like to, like I said, we are the show me state. So yeah. We're going to do it by ourselves here.
All right. Well, good luck. I hope it works. I hope the federal legislation works as well. But as you noted, it never hurts to have something that's got something a bit more local, your own state's name on it, when people are looking at federal legislation and saying, yeah, I don't really think that applies to us. Well, okay, how about this Missouri thing that says the same thing? Oh, yeah, okay, maybe that does.
Comes back to case law issues. If you ever got into a squabble and you ever got into a legal battle, these attorneys know all about how important it is to have that case law and state statute.
Okay. People may want to talk to you about this. Are you open to getting contacted? Probably not hard to find. Yeah, on QRZ.com.
No, QRZ.com, all my information is current on there. And I actually, in my profile page, in my bio, I've put a whole write-up of the whole process. Everything pretty much that we've discussed here is in my bio. You can scroll down and see it's in red. Come on down. There you go.
Yep.
And it begins with what I was able to accomplish at the city level all the way through to where we are today.
And the saga begins. So there you are, KE0KZ, and there's your email address. So you're going to be easy to find. You got to be a QRZ member if you want to get the email address. So just in case, it's scanco@charter.net. scanco@charter.net. And, I was going to put us both together on here. I'm still learning how to run this equipment. It's only been a couple of years. Thanks a lot, Larry. Appreciate your contacting me.
Thank you, sir. And I enjoy your show, and we'll be staying tuned with you. And, if you should want to get an update on that, we'll keep you posted.
Yes, I do. And okay, hang on a second. I'll just close things off here and talk to you offline for a couple more seconds.
Okay. Very good.
So that will be it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Cool. That's very interesting, and I'm glad Larry gave me a call. Let me point out to everybody that Arvin is still watching over my shoulder saying, this costs money. Stick your hand in people's wallets. HamRadioNow.tv is the place to go. One, I haven't had a chance to mention this. One other ham on the Facebook deal had sent me a suggestion, and then he backed it up with a contribution. It was when I was doing the on the road video coming back from the DCC in Chicago, and I had the microphone hanging down from the bill of my cap, and he said, what you need is one of these. And you just stick it on your head, and we'll put the microphone in front of you, and you won't have to be flailing around with that. So I got that. It doesn't fit over the headphones, so kind of have to do like that, and it will sit like that. And this is what it sounds like. So it doesn't sound quite as good as the Heil mic. It doesn't have much in the way of low frequencies. And Larry can't hear me at all. There we go. I'll turn that up, and Larry can hear me now. It doesn't have much in the way of low frequencies, but it's not bad, and I'll have a chance to use it some. So, but it's just not a Heil mic. So, Bob. On the other hand, it cost $80. And I wish I could tell you who that guy was, but I didn't make a note of it that I can refer to at this moment, but it was one of the viewers who was on my Facebook page. So thank you very much. He made a contribution of $50. He said, it's going to cost you 80. I'll get you more than halfway. So he did that. So thank you very much. And I wish I could mention your name. I wasn't prepared to do that. That is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. 73, everybody. We'll see you on whatever the next one. Could be tomorrow. You know, if somebody sends me email and says, hey, I got a great idea for you. Could be tomorrow. Probably not. I got my taxes done. I'm Gary Pierce, Scan4EQ 73. Over and out.